So this video cast is about the practice test for chapter 13. And we'll go through most of the practice test. I'll give you the answers, and for some of them I'll go over an explanation for them. Some of them we'll just quickly go through and you can ask questions later. So the first four questions says use this figure to help answer the question, and it's a solubility curve, and notice it is the solubility of grams of salt in 100 grams of H2O. That should be H2O. And then down here it gives you the temperature in degrees Celsius. So question number one, a mixture containing 100 grams of water and 30 grams of KCl3 is heated to 70 degrees Celsius and thoroughly stirred until no other changes occur. When the system is cooled from 70 to 30, a white crystalline solid forms. What is the best description of the liquid phase of the system? Notice it says the liquid phase of the system. So think of it as this. Here's your beaker that contains your solution, okay? And it says it's 100 grams of water. And inside of the beaker, you also have the water going from 70 to 30, and at 30 degrees Celsius, you've got some white crystalline solid that forms at the bottom of the beaker. So the question is asking about the liquid portion, so this portion right here that remains. It's not asking about the solid right here. So you knew there were 100 grams of water to start with, and so that remains. This contains 100 grams. And originally there were 30 grams of the KCl in there, KClO3. And if you look at the curve right here, I've actually got a color picture of this. Here's the KClO3. Right here at 70 degrees Celsius, KClO3 is right here. And then it's cooled to 30 degrees Celsius down here. And you'll notice at 30 degrees Celsius, the maximum solubility is 10 grams of solute that can dissolve in there. So what happened in this was we had 130 grams total of stuff to start with, but now we have 100 grams of water, and dissolved in there are 10 grams, because remember on the curve here now it says only 10 grams of solute can dissolve at 30 degrees Celsius. You can see that on this graph as well, although this one isn't in color. You can find that it's right here at 30 degrees Celsius. So with 100 grams of water and 10 grams of solute, we now have 110 grams of solution total with 10 grams of solute that dissolves in there. The solid down here, of course, would be 20 grams just sitting there. Question number two, a similar question. Using the solubility curve. Mixture contains 10 grams of water, 40 grams of KClO3, and it's warmed to 84 and thoroughly stirred until no further changes occur. The resulting system is just described as. So if we take a look at this curve once again, here's KClO3. It has 100 grams of water, just like it tells us right here, 100 grams. And it contains 40 grams of KClO3, and it goes to 83 degrees, which is right about here. Follow that up. And this is at right about at 40 degrees, which means you are on this orangish colored line right here. And if you're on that line, that means you have a saturated solution. Above it, you'd be super saturated. Or, you know, if you added more solute, it wouldn't dissolve unless you heated it up. And down here, it would be an unsaturated solution. So you're right at the saturation line. So a saturated solution is the best answer for number two. Page two, a couple more questions about the solubility curve. This is a mixture of 100 grams in water and it's warmed to 30. Thoroughly stirred until no further changes occur. White crystalline solid remains. And then the system is heated to 55. All the white crystalline solid disappears, assuming no change in the amount of water in the solution, which best describes the system. How many grams of KClO3 are dissolved in the solution? So you need to look at the curve once again. KClO3, and look at 55 degrees. If you go up to 55 degrees, you're right here, and how much can dissolve at 55 degrees? Oh, it looks like 20 grams can, right? 20 grams. So you're at a saturated solution now, because at 55 degrees, you're right on the line right here, right on the line. and all of it dissolved, and it told you that it just dissolved at 55, so you're a saturated solution, and 20 grams of solute is dissolved. Question number four, a mixture containing 100 grams of water and 40 grams KCl is warmed to 84 and thoroughly stirred until no fatal changes occur. The system is cooled to 30. How much crystalline solid will form in the solution? So now you have 100 grams of water, which this graph shows you have 100 grams of water, okay? And you have 40 grams of KClO3, so we're right here at 40 grams, okay? And then it's at 84, which means all of it should dissolve because you're at least at a saturated solution, maybe a tiny bit above, okay? 84 degrees Celsius right about here. And then it says thoroughly stirred, and then the system is cooled to 30. So now you go way down here to 30 degrees Celsius. Okay? When you moved from here to here, all of a sudden now you've gone from 40 to 10 in the number of grams that can dissolve, which means that 30 grams of it must have come out of the solution. 30 grams must have come out of the solution and is sitting in the bottom of the beaker undissolved. 10 grams is still dissolved because that would make it a saturated solution, but 30 grams must no longer be dissolved. So how much crystalline solid forms? 30 grams. Number five, the next two questions appeared in the 1999 exam. To make the molarity of this solution, which this one asks about, remember molarity is equal to moles divided by liters. This is moles of solute. They tell you right up here how many grams of solute you have, so you could convert that to moles. So the only other thing that you need to find the molarity is the liters. So determination of the total volume of solution, letter D right here is the best answer. D as in dog for number five. Number six, this is a review problem, and it's a dilution problem where you go from 6 molar HCl, and it says you have 10 milliliters of it, and then you want to make the solution be 0.5 molar, so you want to dilute it quite a bit. And remember, the equation is MIVI is equal to MFVF, where I is initial and F is final. So you can put in your initial molarity here, 6 molar, 10 milliliters of it. And remember, units, as long as they're the same on both sides of the equation, don't really make a whole lot of difference. Don't worry about being in liters for both of them. And then molarity final is 0.5 molar. And your volume that you're going to have to dilute it to, it is going to be the thing that you solve for. But notice they say that what volume of distilled water should be added. They're going to trick you with that when they say added. So anyway, you solve for the V right here. 6 times 10 is 60 divided by 0.5. So that's like saying 60 divided by 1/2. You invert and multiply that and you end up with 120 milliliters. That's going to be your total volume of solution. So how much do you have to add to it? Well, you have to add 110 because you started with 10 milliliters. So 110 is your answer for number six, a nice dilution problem. Number seven, a solution that exists with less than equilibrium concentration of solute present is called an unsaturated solution. Unsaturated, looks like the U came off of that, unsaturated solution. Next page, number eight. Solution formation between a solute and a liquid solvent is favored by, well, the best way you can say solution forms is if you increase the amount of entropy. Entropy, remembered, means disorganization or mixed upness of the solution. So you want to see an increase in entropy. So that limits it down to probably those two right there, B and C. And then also, the best way to do it is have some energy released when the solution is formed. And so you have to have a negative delta H in terms of the system. And so you'd say that there'd be a decrease in enthalpy as well, which is letter B. Number nine. When a colloid has a beam of light shown through its system, it is called the Tyndall effect that occurs. Look on your slideshow and look back at the videos for the slideshow and in the PowerPoint, and you can see that in the last couple of slides. Number 10, which characteristic group makes the substance an alcohol? Well, having a hydroxide group attached to it, like COH. Predict which pure liquids will form an immiscible solution.
Well, a miscible solution means that they dissolve in one another. An immiscible solution means that they will not mix with one another. And remember, the rule for miscibility or for dissolvability is like dissolves like. So if you have something polar, it will dissolve in something polar as long as it's like size in molecular size. And then if they're nonpolar and nonpolar, of course, they'll dissolve in each other. And if one's polar and one's nonpolar, then it's probably not going to. So if you look here, carbon tetrachloride and C7H16 heptane, both are nonpolar, so those should dissolve in each other. H2O and propanol, both have hydrogen bonding, and both are have dipole-dipole forces, both are polar, so those will probably dissolve in each other. Acetone and octane. Acetone's going to be polar because it's got this oxygen stuck off the end, off the middle of it. And then C8H18, of course, is going to be nonpolar, so this is probably your best choice. Number three right here is not going to form a solution. They'll be immiscible in one another. Saturated solution of KNO3, number 12 now, is in equilibrium with excess solute. It's prepared at 20 degrees Celsius, which describes the solution after the temperature of the system has increased to 40 degrees Celsius while still in contact with the solute. Well, the molality of the solute will increase because you're increasing the number of moles that are dissolved in there. And remember, molality is moles divided by kilograms of solvent, moles of solute. So you're actually dissolving more solute in there. The solution remains saturated. It should remain saturated because it says that there's some excess solute in the bottom of the beaker. The only way it could be unsaturated is if all of it dissolves and then, you know, you heat it up even more. And the density of solution should increase. Density, remember, is equal to mass divided by volume. You increase the mass by dissolving more solute in it. So 1, 2, and 3 for letter E. Next page. Number 13. This one's a tricky one, and I could talk about it for quite a while, but as it turns out, the volume of the standard solution used in the titration is reported too large. Because you have some excess water in there, the water makes it look like there's more volume of your standardized sodium hydroxide solution, so you think you used more. And because of that, you report the number of moles of acid used in the titration is reported too large as well. So 1 and 3, which is D, I believe. Number 14, what one additional characteristic of the solution could be used to determine its density? Well, if you use the molarity, you can use the molarity and the molality to help you find the density. Take a look at page, I believe it's page 501 in your textbook, to check that one out a little further. Number 15, what is the boiling point of a 2-molal solution of NaCl in water? The boiling point elevation constant is 0.5, so for this, you use the equation for boiling point change is equal to I times K sub B for boiling times the molality of the solution. I, in this case, since it's NaCl, is going to be 2 because there are Na positive and Cl negative in there, 2 ions. Kb, they tell you, is 0.5. And then the molality, they tell you, is 2. So 2 times 2 is 4, and half of that is 2, so you should have an additional 2-degree temperature change there. And the normal boiling point of water, it would be 100 degrees Celsius, so you'd add 2 degrees to that, so it'd be 102. Now that's assuming you're staying at the same, at standard atmospheric pressure. Let's see, number 16, when an aqueous salt solution is compared to water, the salt solution will have, well, a higher boiling point and a lower freezing point, and therefore a lower vapor pressure, because remember, boiling is not a consequence of temperature. Temperature is a consequence of boiling, and of course, vapor pressure being lowered makes it more difficult for it to boil and come out of its liquid phase. Let's see, a solution contains, so always remember boiling point elevation, freezing point depression. It makes the substance stay in its liquid phase longer. Okay. Number 17, A solution contains equal masses of glucose and toluene. What is the mole fraction of glucose in the solution? So a mole fraction, remember, is symbolized by the letter X, and it's moles, in this case, of glucose divided by total moles. So you need to find the moles of each, add them together, put that on the bottom, and then put the moles of glucose on the top. And it tells us that it contains equal masses. So let's just pick a mass. Why don't we pick 180 grams, okay? 180 grams of glucose is really easy because its molar mass is 180 grams per mole, which means we'd have one mole of glucose. And then it's easy to pick a mass for toluene. It says that it contains equal masses, so that means if we have 180 grams of toluene, it tells us toluene has a molar mass of 90 grams per mole, which means we would have two moles of that. So if you have one mole of the glucose divided by a total of three moles together, 1 + 2 = 3, we'd have one-third mole fraction. Letter B is in. Number 18. Benzene and toluene are mixed together. They form an ideal solution. An ideal solution, remember, is one that follows Raoult's law the best. Raoult's law, remember, is that the pressure, the observed vapor pressure of the solution is equal to the mole fraction of the solvent times the original vapor pressure of the solvent. Okay, follows Raoult's law really well, kind of like ideal gases follow the ideal gas law really well. If benzene has a higher vapor pressure than toluene, then the vapor pressure of the solution that contains an equal number of moles of benzene and toluene will be, well, what's going to happen is you're going to, since you have a mixture of both, you're going to lower the vapor pressure of benzene, okay? But you're going to increase the vapor pressure of toluene, so you should try to meet in the middle. So lower the vapor pressure of benzene and higher than the vapor pressure of toluene, which is C in number 18. Number 19, which can be determined? Turns out that only number 3 can be determined right here. B, number 3. Number 20. These types of problems involve the I, or called the Van't Hoff factor, in the boiling point elevation equation. Know your electrolytes and you'll get them. So which has the highest boiling point? Notice they're all 0.5 molal solutions. So just the concentration of the solute given in molality is not going to make the difference. What's going to make the difference is how many particles you get when each one of these formula units is dissolved in water. Well, with NaCl, you're going to get Na plus and Cl minus, which is 2 particles per solution. KBr, you also get 2 particles. CaCl, CaCl2, is going to give you 2 Cl minuses and a Ca plus plus, so that's going to give you 3 particles. C6H12O6, that's glucose, that's going to give you 1 particle because it's all molecular. How do you know if it's molecular or not? Well, you know, because this is all nonmetals. Remember, if it's got a metal in it, then it's going to be ionic and it'll break up as long as it's soluble. NaNO3 will give you 2 particles per solution as well. So CaCl right here, CaCl3, letter C, is going to give you 3 particles per solution and therefore give you the highest boiling point. Number 21 reads, a substance is dissolved in water forming 0.5 molar solution. If 4 liters of the solution contains 240 grams of the substance, what is the molecular mass? Zoom out just a little bit. We know that molar mass is equal to grams divided by moles. We know our number of grams that's dissolved in there. That's 240 grams. And then we're going to have to divide that by the number of moles that are in the solution. To find that, we can use the molarity triangle. We know that molarity is equal to moles divided by liters. And we're given in the question the molarity, and we're given the number of liters. The molarity and the number of liters. So in this question, to find moles, moles are equal to the molarity, which is 0.5 molar, times the liters, which is 4 liters. 0.5 times 4, half of 4 is 2. So we have 2 moles, and we put that right in here.
to take 240 and divide it by 2, and you end up with 120 grams per mole, which is letter B. Okay, later for this one, but remember in the AP test, the multiple choice, you'll be able to solve in your head. So for this one, the answer turns out to be letter A if you want to go through and work the mathematics using your calculator. Moving on, number 23. This is a Henry's Law problem. And this one you need a calculator for as well. Henry's Law, remember, says that the pressure above a solution, gas pressure above a solution, is equal to the Henry Law's constant times the concentration. And so in this case, they give you some data to find the Henry's Law constant right here. They tell you that at 30 degrees Celsius, this is the concentration of acetylene, and that is at 1 atmosphere of pressure. So you can set up the equation saying that at 1 atmosphere, it's equal to the Henry Law's constant K times the concentration of 0.975 grams per liter. You can solve for K now, dividing both sides of the equation by 0.975 grams per liter. So this is K. Now you can take that and put it back into the Henry's Law equation for the next conditions, where they say at the same temperature, the pressure of the acetylene above the water is reduced to 0.212 atmospheres. So they're saying, what's the concentration now? So take this Henry's Law constant you have right here, plug it back into the new equation where the pressure is 212 atmospheres. And then Henry's Law constant is 1 over 0.975. That's what I got right up here. And then multiply that by C. Now take this equation, solve it for C, and you'll get your answer. And I don't have a calculator in front of me, but you can run that through on yours and solve for C and get the answer. Number 24, which compound is incorrectly classified? CH3OH right here is not a weak electrolyte. It actually turns out it's a non-electrolyte. Everything else is classified correctly. Number 25, KF and KB values are, solution boils at, what temperature does this solution freeze at? So since they give you the boiling point, constant, KB for it, you could set up the equation, assuming that this the solution is the same, delta T is equal to K sub B times the molality right here. And you can solve for the molality of the solution by saying molality is equal to delta T divided by K sub B. Okay. And your change in boiling, as long as you're at atmospheric pressure, is about 7.5 degrees, because normally it boils at 100 degrees. Divide that by the K sub B, which is 1.86, is that right? 1.86. Yep, and then you solve for the molality, and once you have the molality, now you can plug it into the equation delta T is equal to K sub F times this molality that you find. And like I said, I don't have a calculator in front of me right now, and this one would probably require that. You can plug it into the equation here because you're given the KF right here, and you could solve for this one. Number 26. Part per million, part per billion problem. I think this one turns out to be letter B. There hasn't been a part per million, part per billion problem on the AP test in a number of years. Don't think there's going to be one on Monday or Tuesday either. Qualitative Henry's Law problem. What factors also contribute to a decrease in oxygen in the pond? Well, if you increase the temperature, remember, less gas will dissolve. Gases, remember, dissolve better when the water or the solution is colder. Well,
will dissolve less when it's hotter. That's why trout like to live in cold streams. Number 28, a liquid had more. I dissolved oxygen in there for the trout. Number 28, liquid has a vapor pressure, and liquid B has a vapor pressure, which represents the possible solution between the two liquids. A mix. And what you need to do with this one is to get your pressures in the same units. And once you do that, I believe you end up with a vapor pressure in between the two of them, and it turns out to be letter B. Next slide, 29. There's probably almost exactly like this on the exam. Which is expected to give us the greatest increase in the boiling point of water? So your equation for increase in boiling point is delta T is equal to I, the Van Hoff factor, times the molality times the K sub B. Since all the solutions are made with water, K sub B is going to be the same for all of these. Okay, you want to know which one's going to give you your biggest delta T. And of course the molality is different. Going to be different for each one of these because you have a different number of moles, but the same number of same amount of kilograms of water. So if you set these up for letter A, I'm just going to make a little table here: A, B, C, D, and E. For the letter A, what's going to make your biggest delta T? Sucrose is going to give you an I value of 1 because it's molecular. Its molality is going to be 1.25. Okay. For Iron 3 nitrate's formula, now remember, is FeNO33, and when this dissolves, it's going to give you an Fe plus 3 ion and 3 NO3 minus ions for a total of how many ions per formula unit? 3 plus 1 or 4. So the I in this case is going to be 4, and you need to multiply that by 0.25. So this one would give you a total of 1.25 change. This one would give you a total of 1 for a change. Okay, ammonium chloride breaks up into two particles, and that's a 0.5 molal solution, so that's going to end up giving you 1. Calcium sulfate is going to give you 2 particles as well, and that's a 0.6 molal solution, so 2 times 0.6 gives you 1.2. And then lastly, 1 mole of acetic acid. Acetic acid is a weak electrolyte, so you're just going to get 1 for the I. And it's 1 mole as well, so 1 times 1 is 1. Who's going to give you the largest delta T? Looks like the first one, sucrose at 1.25. So letter A is your best answer for 29. See how you can figure those out by knowing the I's and then also knowing the molality right there, as long as the KB is the same because it's all dissolved in water. Number 30. Ethyl alcohol and water become noticeably warmer when mixed. This is due to stronger attractive forces in the mixture than in pure liquids. They release a lot of energy then when those two mix together and they bind together better due to the hydrogen bonding, probably. Number 31, which is the most appropriate method for determining the molar mass? More than one answer. Maybe osmotic pressure, probably. That's the example given in the book. Probably not a question you'll see on the exam. 32. All of the following may be used to determine molar masses, which requires ideal solutions for accurate results. Well, vapor pressures, because then you can use Raoult's law. Pressure is equal to the mole fraction times the pressure original, because ideal solutions, ones that have similar size and similar polarity, mix together to the best and follow Raoult's law the closest. Number 33, molarity are most appropriate for use in osmotic pressure. Remember, the formula for osmotic pressure is pi equals capital MRT. And then in freezing point depression and boiling point elevation, remember, we use molality. And in vapor pressure calculations, we use Raoult's law, which uses mole fraction. For 34, the solubility is 140 grams per 100 milliliters of solution. What is the molar solubility? This takes a little math. Turns out to be letter C. And we're getting there. Number 35. The vapor pressure of an ideal solution is 456. If the vapor pressure of the pure solvent is 832, what is the mole fraction of the non-volatile solute? So you can set up a P equals mole fraction times P original, and if you put in the solution's vapor pressure of 456, and then the original vapor pressure, which is 832, you can get the mole fraction of the solvent. Mole fraction of the solvent. Now notice they ask the solute. So then you'll end up getting the mole fraction of the solvent, and then the solute is that's the fraction of it. And I think that turned out to be 0.452. Subtract that from 1 and you can get the fraction of the other one, which I think turned out to be 0.4548. I think this is right. I don't have a calculator in front of me to check that for sure. I might have that backwards, but that's how to set it up. Be careful what they're asking for the mole fraction of the solute or the solvent. This equation will give you the mole fraction of the solvent. Predict which pure liquids form a miscible solution, or another one of those, and it turns out 1 and 2. I think we had this question earlier, and we asked which one would not, and acetone and octane would not. 37, KCl dissolves in water, close to the touch. It can be included that the only reason the form that they dissolve then is because the entropy increases to overcome the unfavorable heat of dissolution. Because remember, normally solutions want to form when heat is released. Number 38 reads that when 31 grams of a non-ionic substance is dissolved in 2 kilograms of water, the observed freezing point depression is 0.93 degrees Celsius. KF is given, and which expression is equal to the molar mass of the substance? The thing we want to find is molar mass. Molar mass is equal to grams divided by moles. And if we look in the question, we're told that there's 31 grams of the substance dissolved in it. So 31 grams goes on the top of this expression. And then we're going to have to use the freezing point depression equation to find the moles, which will go right down here. If you remember, the freezing point depression equation is delta T is equal to I times KF times the molality of the solution. The delta T is given to us right here. It's 0.93. The I would be 1 because it tells us it's a non-ionic solution, which means it's not going to break up into any other particles. It'll just be 1. The K sub F is given to us for water is 1.86. And then the molality is the thing we're going to want to find. Once we want to find the molality, we can use that to help us find the moles. So solving for molality, we divide both sides by 1.86. And we end up with molality equaling 0.93 divided by 1.86. And this molality right now is equal to our moles of solute, which is the thing we want to find, divided by our kilograms of solvent. Now, if you look back up in the question, they tell us that it's dissolved in 2 kilograms of water. And the 2 kilograms of water would be our solvent, so we can put that in here. Now our equation becomes 0.93 divided by 1.86 is equal to the moles of the solute, the thing we want to find, divided by 2. Multiplying both sides by 2, we now end up with moles equaling 2 times 0.93 divided by 1.86. Now if we take this number of moles right here and substitute it into our molar mass equation right here, because remember molar mass is grams divided by moles, and this thing that I have circled right here is moles, I now get this. I'm going to write it on a separate piece of paper so it fits just a little bit better. 31, which is the grams, divided by 2 times 0.93 divided by 1.86. This is a complex fraction, so invert this, or to do the inverse and multiply by the top. So 31 times 1.86 divided by 2 times 0.93. If you look at this setup now, this turns out to be the same as, I believe it's letter B right here. 31 times 1.86 divided by 2 times 0.93. 39, which of the following 0.2 molar solutions has the highest freezing point? It's going to be the one that gives you the most particles in solution, as long as they're the same concentration. Calcium chloride will give you 3 particles. Nitrogen pentoxide is a molecule, so it'll only give you 1 particle. This will give you 2. This will give you 4 particles. And this will give you 2 particles. So which one will give you the highest freezing point, meaning that it's not depressed the most? Because remember, when you dissolve a lot of solute in a solvent, it is called freezing point depression. So you want it depressed the least, which would mean this one, nitrogen pentoxide, would depress it the least, and therefore would give you the highest freezing point. Last page. All the physical properties change as solute is added in the solution, which is not a colligative property. Surface tension is not. All the other ones are boiling point, melting point, vapor pressure, and osmotic pressure depend on the amount of substance in the solution. Surface tension depends on what the solution or the substance is made out of, like, for instance, water versus something like alcohol or pentane. Which is expected to be the most soluble in hexane? Well, the one that is a nonpolar substance, because hexane is nonpolar, and something that's of a similar size as well. So C6H6, since hexane has 6 carbons, so does C6H6. And then lastly, to make a solution, it says 3.45 and 1.26 moles of substances are mixed, which is needed but not readily available to calculate the molarity of the solution. Well, molarity, remember, is equal to moles divided by liters, moles of solute, which you'd have because you have the moles here and the moles here, but what don't you have is the liters, so you need the volume of the solution.